So may we start.
Back in 2021, acclaimed French director Leos Carax released his first English-language film. Annette, made in collaboration with art rock band Sparks, left audiences puzzled. But in this video, I'm going to offer a rational explanation for all the weird and wonderful things going on in this heroically odd movie. There's another way of understanding it, and it's meta as hell. First things first, you need to put to one side the idea that it's about an opera singer, a comedian, and a singing baby. Instead, think of it as an allegory. It's a story with a hidden meaning, and it's this. The plot explains a unique creative process for the filmmakers followed when writing Annette, and with creators as out there as Carax and the Mael brothers, the making of this film is as interesting as the end result. Let's start with how the authors break the fourth wall to introduce themselves on screen.
The authors are here, so let's not show disdain. The authors are here.
This section references both the audience and the stage, two things that feature prominently throughout. So is the stage outside or is it within? Well, it's both, simultaneously. It's the story of Henry and Anne within the film, and the outside story of the collaboration that produced it. To make sense of this, we can look at what each of the four main characters do on stage, because it's here that we can most clearly see what they symbolise. Let's start with Baby Annette. She represents the movie Annette, the one you're watching right now, and the three parents show different elements of the screenwriter's creativity. There are several clues to this. Notice how her stage looks like a beam from a projector. And like cinema, she has the world's biggest audience. There are several shots of Annette on the big screen, and this is a continuation of the small screens on which we see her debut performance. Screens are also present at Annette's birth, which takes place in a room that feels more like a movie theatre than an operating theatre. Her new fans are young children, representing a new audience for Sparks, unaware of their previous work. The audience is brought up again at Annette's final performance, bringing to mind the thousands of moviegoers who saw the limited theatrical run and the millions who watched it later at home.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Welcome to the Hyperbole Halftime Show. To the thousands who are here in attendance and the millions who are watching at home.
The announcer continues, and it seems to neatly sum up the experience of watching a movie in a dark theatre.
Public appearance. So, ladies and gentlemen, darkness. Then a very sweet, soft light. And then, for all eternity, baby Annette.
Offstage, we see several shots of Henry on his motorcycle. The bright headlamp brings to mind the projectionist beam, and he's in control of where it points, which is the opposite of Annette. She is a victim of the light. Her gift, or rather her curse, is to sing when the moonlight shines on her. This is the same as the movie itself, a musical that plays when light is projected from the booth. The moon, seen everywhere in this movie, is what the movie projection would look like from within the screen. Let's move on to Annette's three parents, starting with the accompanist, played by Simon Helberg. Unlike the others, he doesn't make an onstage appearance, but we learn a lot from his performances behind the scenes. He represents one of the major creative strengths that Sparks brings to this movie project.
I'm an accompanist. I'm an accompanist. I'm an accompanist for Anne. Man's the one with the genius, the grace. I'm the one with the technical expertise.
Yes, he's the one with the technical expertise. Something was represented in both of his set pieces, each requiring great musical skill, which goes beyond that of the other characters. He levels up from accompanist to conducting orchestras, just as Ron and Russell did by composing this soundtrack.
Excuse me a minute.
This isn't the only way in which this character's fate is tied to the making of the movie. There's also the grisly way in which he dies. Think of it like this. The character represents the musical prowess with which Sparks forged their reputation, but it's obscured. It's killed off. Take the opening, with the hiss and buzz of the band setting up. They were instructed to play loosely, and here, Russell is recorded with unflattering reverb after several takes, long into the night.
They hope that it goes the way it's supposed to go. There's fear in their heart, but they can't let it show.
By contrast, the soundtrack album is impeccable.
They hope that it goes the way it's supposed to go. There's fear in their heart, but they can't let it show.
Gentlemen, please make sure your seats are in the upright position. We'll be landing shortly.
Ladies and gentlemen, please make sure your seats are in the upright position. We'll be landing shortly.
This kind of thing happens throughout the movie. Harmonies are lost, characters fall out of microphone range, we even get revivals of classic Spark songs, but in much simpler form. For most of the film, the lyrical style used by Ron and Russell is a lot more basic than what they present on their albums. It's as if they want to obscure just how warm and likeable their music usually is, and that's not the only thing that's changed. Sparks are a band that are known for their humour. In almost 50 years of recording, you'd struggle to name many songs of theirs that don't include the distinct brand of wit and irony. But aside from the opening number, there are no laughs in Annette. It's completely out of character. What better way to represent this than with a comedian that doesn't tell jokes?
So, I'm here to make you laugh tonight. Yes, laugh, laugh, laugh. I'm not sure I can do it tonight. Not sure I should even try.
Henry McHenry's anti-comedy is present throughout the movie. He performs two long stand-up routines, each of which seems designed to alienate viewers, and their focus is on how he can't perform. He reads out a contract that says he's not allowed to make the public laugh. He raps about laughter, describing it in cold physiological terms.
Why should I activate your ventral medial prefrontal cortex so your 15 facial muscles will contract, so your fucking zygomatic muscle will react while your epiglottis have closes, your larynx clap?
He says that somebody broke into his house and stole all his jokes. It's as if the humour that comes so naturally to Sparks has been intentionally written out. Even when he talks about killing his wife, he tickles her, which is laughter, but painful and without humour. And it's not just on stage that we see this. The paparazzi ask him to smile, but he refuses to take off his helmet.
Anne, Henry, how about a smile? Over here!
How about a smile, Anne?
Give us a smile, Anne!
How about a smile, please?
Give us a smile, please!
Henry, please!
In the frame, in the frame!
He tells just the worst jokes.
Shit, Anne. She seems completely naked.
Yes. Laugh, Anne, laugh.
Tonight, while she's singing and dying, I'm babysitting.
Babysitting, as in sitting on a baby. Get it? And then there's this.
You used to laugh, but now you sure ain't laughing at me no more. You used to laugh, but now you sure ain't laughing at me no more.
These words take on an entirely different meaning when put into the context of Sparks leaving the humour at the door. You used to laugh applies as much to the movie audience as to those in the comedy club. They've dropped the jokes that characterise almost every song they've written over 5 decades, and also removed any sense of them being an accessible band with catchy pop songs. Ron and Russell make many cameos in the movie, but this isn't a film designed to convert viewers into Sparks fans. So what's going on? Well, Sparks are making a tragedy, and doing it without compromise. It's as if the only way they can achieve this is by sacrificing so much of what makes them the band they are. To quote the opening song, "We'll sing and die for you, yes, in minor key, and if you want us to kill too, we may agree." It's referring to the ultimate creative sacrifice. With that in mind, let's take another look at Annette's final performance.
And then, for all eternity, baby Annette.
This revisits a haunting melody that we've heard throughout the movie, so it's already in the audience's head, but this time is being done as epic stadium rock. This is such a crushing moment. Baby Annette, like Sparks with their movie Annette, is delivering a tragedy on the world's biggest stage. Had the band wanted a happy ending instead of such a bleak outcome, this could have been a scene like A Star Is Born, showing both the character and the band in all their glory. The audience could have left with a smile on their face and a tune in their ear, maybe even with a crossover hit that would have made Sparks a famous band. But instead, they destroy the song. It sounds worse each time the music restarts, a potential hit record becoming the soundtrack to a crying child who is scared and alone. With these words, Annette delivers a tragedy both outside and within the film. The next time we see Annette, she's no longer a puppet, but a real girl. Up until this point, she's been controlled by her free parents, but with her father's incarceration, her fate is now sealed, as is that of the movie itself. Now imagine if Sparks had chosen a different collaborator for their debut movie. Instead of Leos Carax, they could have worked with somebody like Edgar Wright, who directed the excellent Sparks Brothers documentary. His sensibilities are a good match for the band, making fun and accessible movies. Had he directed Annette, then maybe The Conductor would have survived, Henry McHenry would have earned redemption, and Annette would have given the ultimate feel-good performance. Hopefully you'll agree that this is an ingenious concept for a movie, sacrificing commercial success in order to make an uncompromising art film, and using that as inspiration for the story itself. What's more remarkable is that this hasn't been shared by the filmmakers, so we the audience don't understand the full picture. Well, this too is represented on screen through the performances of Anne, Annette's mother. Notice how far away she is from the auditorium? This is how it looks to those in the theatre. They have no chance of fully appreciating what they're watching.
Adrift all this night. Where is the moon?
She has her back turned, is obscured by drapes, and even when she runs to the lip of the stage, she's unlit. Eventually, she leaves the stage altogether, but despite all of this, the audience love it. She receives a standing ovation when taking her bows, but even then, there's a gulf between her and the audience in the form of the orchestra pit. So who is Anne? Well, the accompanist spells it out for us.
I'm an accompanist. I'm an accompanist. I'm an accompanist for Anne, for Anne. Anne's the one with the genius, the grace. I'm the one with the technical expertise.
That's right. Anne is the genius of Ron and Russell Mael, adored but misunderstood. And if you have any doubt that this is how they view themselves, then think back to their introduction.
The authors are here, so let's not show disdain. The authors are here and there.
And I'm sure you'll agree that they have every right to be. So that brings part one to an end, but there's more coming soon. There's so much more to talk about with this film, and I hope you all agree that it is a work of absolute genius. So thanks for watching, everybody. If you enjoyed it, then please subscribe so you can catch the video as soon as it comes out. Maybe check out my blog or some of my other YouTube videos, and I'll catch you all soon. Cheers. Bye.